you very much. First of all, thank you very much for the invitation. And as Peter mentioned, the topic of this morning session is super resolution. Actually, the topic of super resolution. And the main aim of this first presentation is to give you a general introduction to localization based super resolution microscopy. It's quite trivial that using a traditional fluorescence microscope, you can generate a traditional fluorescence image. The question is, how can you improve the spatial resolution? So how can you actually generate a super resolved image using a traditional fluorescence microscope? So that's the topic of this presentation. And the layout is here. First, I briefly talk about spatial resolution in geometrical optics and in wave optics. I just briefly define the phase step function as the response, the imaging response of the imaging system. If the light source is a point light source, and we'll talk about very briefly about light field image formation in light field microscope. We introduce the rate criteria for spatial resolution. Then, I will talk about the principle of localization-based super-resolution microscopy. I'm going to show you some examples, and we'll finish my talk with issues and artifacts, because it's a relatively new method. The first paper published probably at around 2006. So in geometrical optics, if you would like to generate a perfect image, you have to satisfy three conditions. First of all, the imaging has to be stigmatic. Actually means that the image of a point light source is not a perfect point. The second is the imaging has to be free from image curvature. So the field, if the object is a perfect plane, then the image should be a perfect plane too. And the third one, you can talk about perfect imaging when there is no distortion. It actually means that the magnification is independent of the x and y coordinates. So this is a simulation, and in the ray tracing program you can easily define a perfect lens. But what about reality? In real life, for example, if you can define a split lens, you can immediately realize that the result is not perfect. The image of the point type source is not a perfect point, so the imaging is not stigmatic. You can see you have a quite a strong field curvature, and you have a serious distortion too. So the question is, can we design a perfect lens in reality? So one of the most complex imaging system I know is a spectral lens, basically applied in optical microlithography. This particular one actually contains 21 lenses, and it seems to be a perfect lens because it's stigmatic. I mean, visually at least, it's stigmatic. The image is flat. And there is no distortion. So it actually means that the spatial resolution is infinite. So according to the geometrical optics, you can generate an imaging system with infinite spatial resolution. So let's measure it. Let's measure the intensity distribution in the focus. For example, let's take a CCD camera or a CMOS into the image plane, and just let's shift it back and forward, and let's measure the intensity distribution. And that's what you can see. So you can immediately realize that even in the focal plane, you have a spot. So it's not a mathematical point. It has an extension. It has a quite a special distribution, and even if you have a defocused beam, actually the diffraction limited image of a point type source. It's also referred to as a point type function. It has a cylindrical symmetry. It has a ring system. Actually, the intensity of the side lobes are quite low. For example, the intensity of the first side lobe is approximately 2% of the main peak. And the width of the distribution depends on the wavelength and depends on the numerical aperture of the objective. It's actually linearly proportional to the wavelength and inversely proportional to the numerical aperture. Right. So based on the shape of the point spread function, you can define the spatial resolution, and according to the Rayleigh criteria, two diffraction spots can be resolved if their separation is larger than the distance between the main peak and the very first minimum. In this limiting case, the intensity between the main peaks, between the two main peaks, is approximately 80% of the peaks. Of course, in real life, we have many light sources on the object. So the measured image actually can be calculated as the convolution of the distribution of dye molecules and the point spread function. So here, for example, these red crosses implement the exact position of the dye molecules. You can see the spots, the point spread functions. And this is the final image. So, for example, you can resolve these dyes. Probably these two dyes are very close to the Rayleigh resolution, and probably you can resolve these two dyes. So let's go back to the equation, because I think it's quite. This is the key equation. Again, spatial resolution is linearly proportional to the wavelength and inversely proportional to the numerical aperture. Question: how can we improve the spatial resolution? There are two trivial ways you can do it. Of course, you can reduce the wavelength, or you can increase the numerical aperture. Of course, if you reduce the wavelength, you can actually increase the output fluorescence because you have, in this case, you have to apply photons with higher energy. And probably you will have a problem with the optics, because below 300 nanometers you can't use glasses because of the absorption of the glasses. As I said, you can increase the numerical aperture, but it has a limiting value at around 1.3. So even if you use an inversion objective, for example, a wave inversion objective, the maximum value of the numerical aperture is at around 1.5 or something like this. So that's why spatial resolution is typically, the limit of the spatial resolution is typically at around half of the wavelength. Of course, there are some alternative methods. You can change somehow this Pmol factor. This is an ancient method. You can block the center part of the aperture, so you can actually apply angular apertures, and based on the obstruction ratio, you can improve the spatial resolution. The obstruction ratio is the ratio of the center of non-transparent part and the radius of the full aperture. So, for example, in this case, the absorption ratio is 90%, and in this case, you can improve the spatial resolution by a factor of 1.6. But typically, PSF engineering methods introduce a significant loss of light, just because you block. Actually, in this particular case, you block the center part of the beam. So that's why, in the last, I would say, 15-20 years, several alternative methods have been proposed for super resolution. When we're talking about super resolution, we're typically talking about techniques are fluorescence techniques, and just very briefly, I talk about the fluorescence microscopy. The fluorescence microscopy, you have to label the sample with fluorescence dyes, and you have to dry them. For example, you can use white light. In this particular case, you have to apply excitation filter, so you have to select the appropriate wavelength. And using the dichroic and this objective, you can excite the sample. And typically, using the very same objective, you can generate, you can create image on the surface of the detector. And don't forget, the emitted light is redshifted. That's why you can spectrally select the emitted light from the excitation. So that's how you can actually capture fluorescence images. And of course, you can do multicolor imaging. You just have to label different proteins with different dyes, and of course you have to excite the different lasers. So let's go back to localization-based microscopy. First of all, let's assume you have a single fluorophores in the region of interest, just one dye molecule. So you can excite it. Actually, you can excite it several times, and using the very same, I just mentioned, the imaging system, you can generate the image in front of the detector, and this is the point spread function, actually, of the system, because this is the image of a point like source. And typically, in localization-based microscopy, you apply an array detector. So you have a CCD camera, or you have a CMOS, and that's what you can detect. So this is the measured data. And the point is that you know that this is the image of a point-like source. So this is the point spread function of the imaging system, and you can fit the point spread function to the measured data. So you can fit the point spread function to the measured data, and you can determine the central position. And this peak position actually gives you the exact location of the fluorophore. And you can save the XY coordinates, and that's how you localize this fluorescence molecule. You typically fit Gaussian to the measured data because it's simple and quite, and it's actually pretty fast, because you can separate the XY coordinates, so you can determine the exact X and Y coordinates independently. And be honest, that's the second reason. We don't really care about the shape of the point spread function. We're only interested in the P position. So that's the second reason. And using a high numerical aperture objective, the point spread function of the imaging system is actually quite close to the Gaussian distribution. So it's very close to the reality. So the question is, how precisely you can determine the position of these dye molecules? So here is the equation. It actually gives you the accuracy of the localization. It depends on the different parameters, just like it depends on the pixel size, the PSF, the size of the PSF. Actually, it depends on the standard deviation of the point spread function. Actually, it depends on the ratio of the pixel size and the standard deviation of the point spread function. It also strongly depends on the number of photons you can collect, and it also depends on the background. So this curve actually depicts the localization precision as function of number of photons you collect. So as you can see, the larger the photon number, the better the localization precision. For example, if you would like to localize a dye molecule with a precision of 10 nanometer, then you have to collect at least refractive index of the sample is at around 1.3. It's water or something like that. So it's typically, it's a biological sample. And you can see the very low background. This is because in this particular case, just the adolescent field excites the sample. And the penetration depth of the adolescent field is at approximately 50 nanometers. Of course, it depends on the angle of incidence. It slightly depends on the wavelength. But generally speaking, I would say it's at approximately 100 nanometer. And don't forget the exponential decay. So how can you do this? Of course, there are several techniques you can align to illumination. So this is the objective, and this is the lens that focuses the beam into the back focal plane. And of course, if you shift this lens up and down, you can align the position of this focus, and you can set the angle of incidence on the sample. This is the second option. In this case, you have an additional mirror here in the back focal plane of this focusing lens. And if you tilt this mirror, you can set the angle of incidence right here. We actually use this arrangement, and you will see it in the lab after lunch. Of course, localization of a single fluorophore in the region of interest is not a big deal. So typically, we have many fluorophores, and in localization-based microscopy, somehow we have to control the on-off states of these molecules. So in localization-based microscopy, we typically capture an image stack, and we have to evaluate this image stack frame by frame. So first you have to select the candidates. You have to fit the Gaussian. You have to determine the X and Y positions. Then you have to select the true localizations. Of course, you have to save the XY coordinates. You have to register the final high resolution image, and that's quite critical. Finally, you have to visualize the high resolution image. This is just another simulation. Actually, it's I borrowed it from Eric. So this is the object. It's quite small because the width is only 2 microns. This is the size of the point spread function of the imaging system. And using an imaging system with such a point spread function, you can generate an aerial image in front of the camera. It looks something like this. And because the vector is pixelated, and this is the pixel size, that's what you can detect. So no chance, you can't read the message. But in localization based microscopy, somehow you have to control the molecules, and you can turn them on and off. And so in this technique, that's what you can see. You have to capture an image stack, which is something like this, and you have to evaluate the frames. So you have to determine the X and Y positions, and you have to register and visualize the final image. So now you can see the high resolution image. So here's the protocol. So first of all, you have to find a switchable molecule. You can use, for instance, proteins, or you can see apply a traditional organic dyes. Somehow you have to label the sample. Then you have to capture many frames, sometimes 10,000 images is enough. Sometimes you have to capture 100,000 frames. Then you have to use a localization software for localization, and then you have to reconstruct the final high resolution image. how can you control the on-off states? How can you control the rate between these states? And several methods have been proposed in the last, I would say, 20 years. I will talk about PaLM just very briefly and DSTOR. So in PaLM actually means photoactivated localization microscopy, and in photoactivated localization microscopy, you have to apply photoactivated fluorescence proteins. So it's the name of this protein is quite misleading because it says it's fluorescence protein, but the point is that the native state of these proteins is not fluorescent. It's not fluorescence, but you can actually turn them on. So using UV light, something at around 4 or 5, this is actually the absorption emission spectra of the photoactivatable green fluorescence protein. So using UV light at around 4 or 5, you can turn on the molecule, so you can switch them on, and you can read them out. So originally, all the molecules in their off state, in their native state, and even if you use the argon ion laser before ATM somewhere here, you can't detect the signal because they are dark. You have to use the 4 or 5. You can turn on a few molecules. Actually, you have to use the 4 or 5 is at very low intensity, and the process is totally stochastic. So you can turn them on, and because the argon ion laser is always on, you can read them out immediately. You have to apply relatively high energy, high laser power. So you have to collect as many photons as possible, because as I mentioned, the localization precision detect strongly depends on the number of photons. And after a while, you can photobleach these molecules, and using again the 4 or 5 laser, you can turn on new molecules. So that's, of course, you can repeat this process several times, and that's how you can collect the data for the localization software. So originally all the molecules are in their off state. Using the 4 or 5 laser, you can turn them on, you can read them out, you have to collect as many photons as possible, and then you can photobleach them. So in this method, you can localize a single fluorophore just once because of the photobleaching. There are several fluorescence proteins you can actually apply for PaLM, so you can do multicolor PaLM, I would say, literally. But what was the problem with PaLM? There's one problem. The quantum efficiency of these fluorescence proteins are not very high. In other words, they are quite they are not very bright. And again, the localization precision depends on the number of photons. It would be nice to apply very, very bright dye molecules, just like organic dye molecules typically used for confocal microscopy, just like Alexa, Apple, dye, and things like that. It is possible, but it's a different method. It's referred to as stochastic optical reconstruction microscopy, or direct stochastic optical reconstruction microscopy. The problem is that in DSTOR you have to apply a switching buffer, because you have to turn off these molecules, and in DSTOR again you have to use a switching buffer, and you have to pump almost all the molecules into off state, and you can actually in this case using a UV light you can pump back to the active state that you want. So again, there are several dye molecules can be applied for store microscopy, so you can do multiple imaging again routinely. So let me show you some examples. The very first one is the resolution again is around the half of the wavelength, so probably it's 200, 300 nanometers. But in store, the localization precision is at around 10 nanometers. So it is a problem. For example, we measured the width of these amyloid fibrils, and the measured width was at around 47 nanometers, and we actually know that the width of the fibril is probably at around 10 nanometers. And this is because of the length of the linker. So you had the fibril, you had the long linkers, and the end of the linkers you had the dying molecules. So therefore, it would be nice to apply as short linkers as possible. The second issue is the labeling density. This method is very sensitive to the labeling density. This is a simulation when we generated the image of four vesicles. You can see 1, 2, 3, 4. And we changed the number of molecules linked to the vesicles. It's here. And this is the exposure time of the frame rate of the detector. And as you can see here, when the labeling density is very high, you have this artifact, these bridges between the vesicles. So the explanation is quite easy. So if the labeling density is low, then we typically have just a single active fluorophore per frame. So you can localize it, you can excite it, you can localize it, and you have two localizations. But if you increase the labeling density, so you have high labeling density, then the propensity you have two or even more active fluorophores per frame is much higher. And for example, in this case, you have false localization just between these two vesicles, and these false localization actually generate these bridges between the vesicles. It is a real problem. This is a measurement, and probably you can see these bridges between these vesicles. This is another issue. Actually, we like Storm not because of its speed, because again, we have to capture an image stack. It takes for a while, probably 5-10 minutes, and therefore mechanical drift is a critical issue. This is a measurement actually. Use the very same sample, and on the left hand side, we turn on the spectral designation instead or localization based methods. Talk about the localization, you can achieve spatial resolution so that you can go down easily to the sub 20 nanometer regime, but you have to apply switchable fluorescence molecules. You have to apply a special algorithm, and the imaging parameters are very, very critical, and of course the implementation of the super resolved image is also critical. So, and don't forget, after launch, we actually organized a lab visit. I will ask you to form three groups, because you would like to talk about the sample preparation, the optical system,